you give up. I know.
I know that I can stand.
Hang on, joy is coming. I know
no it is. No matter what you may come my way.
Jesus, my life.
My life is in
hallelujah, you. Hallelujah. With him, I know I can take it.
Jesus, I
can take it. With him, I know.
Troubles don't to the house where I used to live. The grass had grown up and it covered the door. Someone across the street said, I know whom you see, but they don't live here anymore. They are somewhere. They don't come here anymore.
kitchen one evening while she was fixing supper, and he handed her a piece of paper that he had been writing on. And after wiping her hands on her apron, she took the letter in her hands and she read it. And this is what it said. For mowing the yard, $5. And for making up my own bed this week, $1. For going to the store, 50 cents. And playing with little brother while you went shopping, 25 cents. Taking out the trash, $1. And for getting a good report card, $5. And for raking the yard, $2. Total owed, $14.75. Well, she looked at him standing there expecting, and 1,000 memories began to flash through her mind. So she picked up the pen and...
to the Lord. And so then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. Our Savior Jesus Christ abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and of hell. Because I live, you will live also, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain, for the first things are passed away. Let us pray.
We come to glorify you, Lord. We come to magnify you because you are worthy to be praised this morning. Father God, we give you thanks for allowing us to be in your presence this morning. In your presence where there's fullness of joy, and at your right hand there's pleasures forevermore. Thank you, God, for your comfort, God. Thank you for comforting the bereaved family at this time. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to be here in your presence, for traveling with us safely, mighty God. Father God, as we prepare, mighty God, to say goodbye this morning, Father God, I pray, God, that you order our steps accordingly in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father God, we say thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning again, everyone. Let us give God thanks again to be here this morning. It's not a right that we have to be here, but it's a privilege that was granted to us, all right, this morning. And as we go on into the program this morning, we will be starting off with the statement of purpose that will be given by Pastor Leslie.
We are met in this solemn moment to commend Dr. Noel Lloyd Daly. Doyley. I apologize. Into the hands of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer, by whose stripes we are healed, and in whose name alone we have salvation. Let us then recall to mind the life of our deceased brother in humble trust. Hear the words of Holy Scripture and hear the words of tributes to him.
We will start now by going into the tributes. So we will have four tributes. And the first tribute will be by Jackie Channel. Are you here, Jackie? All right. Can you proceed? After Jackie, I'm going to ask President Dr. Oswald Dunn to just follow her. And then the tribute by the children. And then Dr. Trevor Acker. And we are going to go in that order.
Good morning, everyone. We are here this morning to remember the life of Dr. Noel Doyley, known to many as just Doc. If we were to take a moment, each of us who knew him, to reflect on our fondest memory or just a vivid picture of him, what would it be? Some will have just one, some will have a whole lot. I was privileged to work with Dr. Doyley for many years. Many recollections come to my mind. His imposing stature. He would walk into a room and it's as if he would fill the room. Some patients would be scared or cowardly because they thought he was such a big man and they didn't know what he was going to do. But he had a way with people. So he would say something funny and he would erupt in laughter. Everybody starts laughing. And before you know it, the patient and all the people around him would be laughing. The laughter that he created was contagious. Everybody would hear his laughter and the whole world, everybody would erupt in laughter. That would also put the patient at ease because they too would be laughing and then we would have no problem afterwards. Everybody would be at ease. I also think that he was one of the most knowledgeable and skilled persons that I've worked with. He was good at his craft. I still to this day compare the work of other dentists and other dental personnel by his standards. However, I'm not here to speak on my own behalf because I wouldn't be able to summarize it. It's been a long time and a lot to think of. So I'll be reading a tribute by one of his former employees. Her name was Geraldine Francis, and she was encouraged by him. She was inspired by him, and she went on to become a dental nurse. This is her tribute. Dr. Doyley, you were a gentle giant, always smiling. You gave me my first opportunity. You gave me my first opportunity at being independent. You gave me my first job. I learned so much from you. You were an amazing, talented dentist who have touched the lives of many positively. Watching you work was like watching a story unfold. Dentistry was your dentistry, and your children were your first two loves. You have lived a life, you have lived life to the fullest, and have experiences that some of us can only dream about. You were strong and resilient. No matter what is happening, you always find something to laugh about. Today, we say goodbye to an amazing, talented, loving human being. But heaven has welcomed a happy angel. Glide gently into the night, Dr. Doyley. Rest in peace.
Morning, all. The children of Dr. Noel Doyley, other family members, both here in Jamaica and in Cuba, friends all. Today, I bring you a tribute on behalf of the Jamaica Dental Association and as a friend of Noel. Dr. Noel Doyley was a member of the Jamaica Dental Fraternity for more than 40 years. Over the years, his presence was seen and felt at many of our continuing educational meetings, conventions, and social activities. He graduated from the Dental Faculty, University of Santa Clara, which is situated in the middle of Cuba. He was also a personal friend of mine. From the day I arrived in Sav-la-mar in 1987 and visited with him, our bond was not only in dentistry, but having studied myself in Cuba, we shared the Spanish language and culture. For his family members and friends in his birth country, Cuba, I say, and please pardon me while I speak in Spanish to those who are listening and watching in Cuba. Tengan fe en el hecho de que Noel contribuyó mucho al pueblo jamaicano, en particular a los pobres, en cuanto a la cantidad de personas que ha recibido tratamiento dental gratis. Damos gracias a la familia y al pueblo y al gobierno cubano para el préstamo del internacionalista Noel Doyley. Okay. Noel achieved legendary status in the parish of being known by one name only, Doyley. There was no doubt in anybody's mind who was being referred to when you say Doyley. His personality was indeed larger than life. His contribution to dentistry in Westmoreland is legendary. Indeed, his legacy will live on for many, many years. He was the only dental surgeon in this parish for a long, long time. And he relieved many a toothache, both in the public sector and in his private practice. Dr. Doyley's temperament, demeanor, and personality was ideally suited for his career as a dental surgeon. His kind disposition, with a booming laugh, as was referred to earlier, ending with a cough and a smile emanating from his heart, along with a strong hug, were just some of his endearing qualities. Anybody who knows Noel can relate to that. On behalf of the Jamaica Dental Association, I bring condolences to his children and other family members, both here in Jamaica and in Cuba. We salute you, Dr. Noel Lloyd Doyley, for your contribution to dentistry in Jamaica. May his soul rest in peace. Thank you.
Good morning, all the people that will call Dr. Playful, sometimes stubborn, maybe a bit annoying sometimes, you know? That'd be around family. He had a wonderful life. When I was younger, one thing I used to do was around 6 or 8 years old, I used to crawl on my dad's back, you know? I always saw him when I was that young. He was a big lion to me, and I was his little cub. And I used to be on his back, you know, crawling. He didn't mind me at all. He was very comforting to be around. Yeah. I remember periods of when I remember periods when Dad and I, my cousin Donato, we used to go to the beach, and we used to have fun, you know, swim. Laugh. He was a good man to all you people in Sav, and to family when he could. The one thing that annoyed me with Dad, I could never get past the snoring. Honest to God, only person that could do it was Ellie. It was just him to know that he was there. That used to take me to prep school a lot. He used to take me to primary school. He had the car. He picked me a blade sometimes, but you know how it goes. He scolded me. Mom did most of the work when it comes to scolding. She shaped me into the person that I am today. She shaped me into someone who respects and she's a God-fearing person, and I also fear God. You know, I'm laughing for anything. He used to reward me when I achieved great things. Like, whenever I got a good report card, he used to give me gifts or some money. One thing that one of my most memorable moments of him is when I graduated from high school. It's just a comfort. Him. On my graduation day, after I got my diploma, we went to the Chinese, we went to a fancy Chinese, I don't remember the name, to be honest with you. All I know it was good food, and I enjoyed, and it's always a comfort and just having them there to eat. My father, he was a brilliant man. Everybody knew Doc Doyley. I can't believe how my father was so famous.
Not famous, well known.
Well known. Well, the family enjoyed helping people. Mm-hmm. Friends and drink. He'd come home sometimes drunk, you know. Yeah. But, oh, remember the good times. Remember the good times about him. He's just, I admit that my father wasn't perfect at all. None of us are. We saw him. He told us of our grandparents. The Doyleys are very strong. In hindsight, in summary. Let me finish up with this. Dr. Doyley was a strong person and a caring person. And I want to remember him as that. Even though he wasn't perfect, he wasn't always there, but it doesn't matter.
My father was my best friend, my hero, my protector, and my first love. As Dr. Dunn and Miss Shanakitan laugh, and when he laughs, it becomes so contagious. His laugh sounds like he came from his foot bottom, and then tears would come from his eyes. Or when he's laughing at you, it's nothing good. He was overprotective of his children. So much so, if he was meeting a friend or of one of his children, he would drill them, which became embarrassing for us from time to time. Daddy also had pulling a gear coming over Spurtry Hill. And when he is doing this, he will be sleeping on one of his hands. Just listen for him to snore. If you do have an emergency, he's the worst person to call. They had a wedding, and Daddy danced the night away. And honestly, that's the image I want to continuously keep in my head of my father. And it hurts that he's gone, but I know he's in God's bosom, and he's going to be our guardian angels no matter what. Daddy, I love you, and I miss you, and this is hard.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Today we're here to celebrate the life of Doc, as everybody knows, you know. So I'm just here to just a reminder for all things under the sun. We laugh, we cry, we love, we hate, we fart, we sing, we dance, we live, and we die. Breath will leave our bodies, and we leave our loved ones behind. So we must live. Let your life be filled with love, joy, peace, happiness, forgiveness, and even sadness. You may think sadness does not belong, but with sadness, hurt, and pain, we would not know real and true love. I stand here. We stand here. We look strong, but we struggle with the loss of accepting the death of our father. We're happy though that there's no more pain, but I am sad that the present became the past, and that is the greatest conflict of all. Today we stand here to say goodbye, but how can we? We will not say goodbye. What we will say is that we will never forget. Life is unpredictable. We can plan, we can anticipate, but our map has already been written. Our beginning and end has already been written. We may change routes, but the ending is still the same. We've had great experience with loss, and we thought we could be prepared. We could anticipate the feelings, but how wrong were we? I thank God for strengthening us, but we will not forget. We will not forget how strong you were, Daddy. We will not forget the intelligence you possessed. We will not forget the love you showered us all with. We will not lose the memories of you that we possess. We will not forget you, Daddy. You will live in our hearts forever. Don't take life for granted. Live and love. May the grace of our Lord and Savior be with us all during this time.
Good morning, everybody. There's so much to say in so little words. I didn't prepare anything this morning because I didn't know where to start. So I'm just going to speak in little words from my heart as I'm led. My daddy, as everybody knows. Our journey together was one that will remain for a lifetime. It's unending. There's so much memories. There's always a fun moment around Daddy, never a dull one. The funny thing about it is that he was everybody's friend. The madman, low class, high class, it doesn't matter. And he was accepted by everyone, not only in Sav-la-mar, but regionally, internationally. There are people that our father knew that we didn't even know that he knew them, or they were his patients or whatever, from before we were born. And even people's children, you know, have come in contact with him and they knew of him, and you know, and it goes on. I have so much fond memories of him. And I remember one particular, I know I don't want to take this thing too long, you know, because we want to work with time. I was always known as Boom. You can call me Boom. But I never used to like when nobody called me Boom. When me hear nobody else call me Boom, I'm like, no call me so, no call me so. And even when I was, he used to take me to school, and then I said, boom, boom. And then, like, my friends would hear some. He said, Daddy, he said, don't call me in a public, man. I don't like it. And then they start teasing me and say, oh, your father call you, boom. And I said, no call me, so. So he was the only one that could call me boom, and I was comfortable with it up until this very day. Even in his latter days, he would say, boom, boom, and in my life, I mean, I said, like, you know, he was reminiscing, you know, on the memories. There's one particular memory I have. My father was very fond of music, of sports, especially baseball. and he could dance very well. He was an excellent dancer. Excellent. Spanish, Jamaica, everything, anything at all, he would just rock. My father was life. He was just full of energy. The right energy at all times. There's never dull. Even if he's having a sad day or a bad day, it wouldn't show. You know, he was such a person that, you know, he could conceal whatever he's going through and you wouldn't realize. He was always just there for people. I didn't know that my father had soul. He was a confidant of so many people, to be honest with you. There are things that I don't, that we don't even know, that, you know, people go to him and they share their personal life and situations and issues with and all that.
Many people, to be honest with you.
There are things that I don't, that we don't even know, that, you know, people go to him and they share their personal life.
Whatever you do it in secret and God will reward you openly. You know, I know a lot more people wanted to be here, but because of the COVID and all that, and the restrictions, they can't. And the funny thing about it is that, you know, everybody has a very good memory of him. Everybody the funny was thing about that he was a happy person, everybody has a very good. And that's why, you know, we don't really want to leave here in a sad state, as we're trying to serve
a happy person.
We want to live in a happy state doing that. And that's why, you know, we don't really want to leave here as in a sad state, as we're trying to serve. And we know that we want to be in a happy state.
And that's why, you know, we don't really want to
in the afterlife.
Here as in a sad state, as we're trying to serve.
And there's one part that we want to be in a happy state. And that's why I remember when I was in the afterlife. I would always anticipate sports day because I know that even being busy all the way always late, it's still a show, you know. And I remember one particular day when I was about 6 years old. Yes, he said that. All right, he said that he met me at your race, and we started at my mom's gate to run up on Sigrid Street to run up the road, and we take off, you know, man. And when we take off, me I look me and say, when me look behind me, I thought he'd drop on his belly. And when he drop on his belly, all him do, you know, I laugh. All him do, I laugh. Because when you see daddy, it's just laughter. When you see him, it's like, it's a big, beautiful smile just light up your day. And even if, like, sometime you're mad at him or whatever, funny come, it's like, I don't know, he had this thing about him. Oh, my God. It just charms you. It's just charming, and it just calms you down, and it's like, you can't mad at him again. Yes. You're like, okay, daddy, okay, all right. Boom, boom, you know? But, you know, each of us as siblings, we have our own personal experience with him. And, you know, he taught us well. He encouraged us. He was very brilliant, you know? He's always helping us with the homework. You know, even if we're always on the go or busy, he would sit down and, especially the mathematics, yeah, you know, the physics, he was very good. And up until this very day, he's very good at numbers, you know. You know, he could recite a number in his head, you know. He don't, even until this very day, up until, you know, before his departure from us, his brain was very, very sharp, trust me. And, you know, I am happy that we were able to spend time with him, you know, given the fact that all of us have our fair share of responsibilities and obligation, but God would have it that we spend time together, not even realizing that he was preparing us for this road. You know, sometimes God will be preparing you for stuff and you don't even realize it until when we reach the crossroad and you look back into retrospect, you realize that all this was just a preparation. We were able to go to the beach, you know, and he wanted to go back so bad, but then the lockdown with COVID-19, no one could go out. And not knowing that the photos that we took were going to be precious memories. And today we're here standing, you know, to represent him. And with God's grace, we still want to make him proud, or continue to make him proud. And to also, you know, we wanted him to walk us down the aisle, but, you know, he won't be around anymore, which, you know, we're trying to accept it because everybody's days are numbered. Oh,
All our days are numbered. We don't know when. That's why it's important to live now. Be the best version of yourself now. Because we don't know what's going to happen even later on. Thank you.
We have heard all the tributes.
No.
Good afternoon, everyone. I can understand when it is said that you have heard all the tributes, because I'm not so sure there's much I can add to what has already been said. But when you're the last person to speak, there's a lot of responsibilities that are placed on your shoulder. So I myself will just be speaking freely. Dr. Noel Doyley, otherwise known as Kingman or Dalling, was amongst the first set of Cuban doctors to have graced our shores in the latter part of the 70s. And shortly after, he was assigned to the Sav-la-mar Public General Hospital. And as a dentist, his impact was immediately felt in the sense that he has brought about a new advanced area of the craft never before seen. Because prior to that, what you have was some little people about the place which are actually teeth mechanics. So Dr. Doyley was the first one to have introduced the arts and science of dentistry in the parish. Doc, shortly after getting here, became the leader of what was known as the Doyley set. And he was so popular in the 70s that just about everybody wanted to be associated with Doc, whether to have a drink or just to be in his presence. He made us feel well, and he was so welcome that more at times we felt that he was more Jamaican than us. And it reached to a point where, regrettably, in the 80s, the Siaga-led government broke diplomatic relationship with Cuba. And when he realized that the doctors had to go home, he said the doctors could stay. Well, Dr. Doyley found his home here in Jamaica, and he and a few of them stayed back. Thereafter, he continued serving the people of Sav-la-mar, and then he went into private practice at 2 Morris Street. Everybody remember, if you're old enough, that area. Doc was always seen with the marginalized, the dispossessed, and the poor. He enjoyed that company. And it was so impactful that in the early 80s, he was most popular than any other politicians in this parish. Doc went on into private practice, and then he also advanced his skills that when persons like our president, Dr. Dunn, came, and I subsequently came after, and there was like Dr. Nepal, the way was set for us. We within our fraternity owe Dr. Doyley a debt that cannot be paid. In Spanish, we say that la deuda es impagable. We cannot pay Dr. Doyley, nor can any Cuban trained or Cubans that came on mission after Dr. Doyley in the 70s. Because the first thing the people of Sav-la-mar asked, then good like Doyley said, everybody said, then good like Doyley said, Doyley was the man. And on the social scene, I remember that Red Tercel, that Jerry Curl, and those eyes. And we used to par, when I was a student, And he was the one who actually recommended that I go and do dentistry, and he gave me employment as a student. Let me just emphasize on that. So as a student, we used to par. And I will tell you something. Doc don't pass any miniskirt crossing so easy. And then it reached a point now where he did not have to pass the miniskirt crossing. He was blockaded. Because those eyes, the ladies told me, he has the eyes, the charm, and the charisma. Trust me. He was a lover of red stripe beer. No, I'm going to tell you how the Heineken came in. I'm going to tell you. Allow me to go through first. Allow you to go through. He was a lover of red stripe beer. And he makes no apology about that. But in latter years, I don't know why he has changed from red to green. But I realize that he has been drinking Heineken. Doc live every day as if it was his last day. When you talk about a man who love life, enjoy life, he was not materialistic. If Dr. Doyle was materialistic, he would own the whole of Sav-la-mar. He just want to live and be happy, and he love his children. And he, call a spade, he love women. Yes, he love women. Talk about the man as how the man is. I saw the man still. Now, when Doc lost his son a few years ago, I know it took a toll on him. We have met one subsequent to that, and a mutual friend of ours came by the office, and he said, I don't know if that person is here, I won't call his name. He said, when last you see Dalling? He said, boy, a long time I didn't see him, you know. He said, call him up, man. So call him up, and we plan a little get-together for him. It was a nice little spot, just three persons. You wouldn't believe this. Quiet, but where men can reason as men. So we went, and we have spiritual beverages and food prepared. And we were there waiting, couldn't see Doc. So we started having a few sips. So finally, when he got in, he came in a shorts. So he actually bending like this. So when he came and he saw the preparation, I said, he did not know what to do. He did not know if he should stand up. He did not know if he should sit down. And he did not know if he should cry. But his eyes get watery. And finally, he sat. He said, me. If you know him well, I'm going to just take a late now. You can't see from behind. Me. Me never prepared. Feed this in a bath, man. Boy, touch me. So I said, all right. So I said, all right, that's why I go party. Life is not worthwhile living without surprises. He said, but no, you look good, man. You look good. I said, yeah, man. He said, I walk out yesterday. He said, me have four hamper. 1 year old. 1 year old. And 2 years old. When me a come down, boss, me no eat ice cream. So, but me going to the ice cream place of me, but my wife's big so. So me told her, as me do so, first bite me a doctor said, oh, you can't resist it, eh? He said, me feel bad. But here the thing, don't I go ahead and tweet up. But you know this one?
What am I going to do again?
That's the man. That's the man that I know. And I want to tell you this. Whatever happened in his latter days is between him and his God. But let me tell you something. For those of us who know Doc, I even want to say new, me attack it as it is, know Doc. We would not want to see him lying down suffering, and he would not want that. Because, as I know, neither of us could go and visit Doc under such circumstances. And for the children and the mothers of his children and all his friends, the way he went is the way he would have liked to go. My friend, in English we say, rest in peace. And in Spanish we would say, en paz, descansa. Nos veremos. Adios.
Thank you, everyone. We have heard it all. I don't think there's much more. Everybody have at some point encountered Dr. Doyley, myself included. And it is great to be remembered. It is always good to remembered as a great role model. All right? It's good to remember the life that he lived and the impact he had on each and every one of us here today. So we are going to continue with the eulogy. Sonia Foote.
Good morning, everyone. It's really an honor for me to stand here to read the eulogy. Problem is, there's hardly anything left for me to say because almost everything has been touched by somebody. Nevertheless, on behalf of the family, I would like to begin by thanking everyone for coming to celebrate the life of Dr. Noel Lloyd Doyley. He was the most free-spirited, kind, caring, and loving person I've ever known, and I know many of you agree. He knew the entire Jamaica, and people gravitated to his charismatic personality. He touched the lives of many people and always left a mark. You could never be upset with him for too long because of his loving spark and great sense of humor that could melt your heart. Noel Lloyd Doyley was born on May 18, 1947, in a country area in Cuba called Ciego de Avila. He was the middle child for Solomon Doyley and Edna Johnson. He had three brothers named Jorge, Raul, and Roberto, and three sisters, Dalita, Elsa, and Mirta. Noel Doyley attended Julio Antonio Melia Pre-University in Havana, where he completed high school. He furthered his studies at the University of Havana. His faculty was stomatology, which is a study of the structure, function, and diseases of the oral cavity, commonly called the mouth. So he became Dr. Noel Lloyd Doyley in the year 1972, and the faculty batch in which he graduated was the largest in the history of Cuba. Dr. Doyley was part of a team of professionals who came to Jamaica in the year 1979 through an agreement between the government of Jamaica and the government of Cuba. The agreement was reached in an effort to improve our healthcare system. When he first came to Jamaica, he worked in St. Anne and then came to Westmoreland. For more than 20 years, he He worked on and off with the Jamaican government in many health clinic facilities in Jamaica. These included Sav-la-mar Health Clinic, Ramble Health Clinic, Lucy, Green Island, Cornwall Regional, and Alexandria Health Center. In addition, his services were also engaged by Dr. D.K. Duncan in Kingston. While working in Jamaica with the Jamaican government, he started his own practice in the year 1981. He loved his job and was very good at it. He was one of the best dentists in Westmoreland. People will tell you that he was fast, professional, and accurate when he was doing an extraction. If you knew Dr. Doyley well and you disclosed to him that you did not have any money to do whatever you needed to do, whether it was an extraction, cleaning, or whatever, he would still do it free of cost. He was a humanitarian at heart and took care of people whom he loved and cared about. He had one of the sweetest souls you could ever encounter. He had a heart of gold. He helped many people from all walks of life wherever he went. After Dr. Doyley came to Jamaica, he met and courted Hopi Brissett. They were joined in holy matrimony on February 7, 1981. This union produced two children, namely Yamilka and Elihu. Overall, Dr. Doyley fathered seven children, namely Noelito, who currently lives in Cuba and is the eldest, Yamilka, his first daughter, Naelia, Elihu, who predeceased him, Andre, Luan, and the youngest, Noelio. Dr. Doyley was proud of all of his children, from the eldest to the youngest. He was proud to see them graduate from university and bragged about each of them. He would sit and encourage them to do their utmost best. He loved each of them and loved them even more when they called him daddy all the time. His children and his job were prized possessions. He spent his latter years with his companion, Ina Mae Taylor, who also became his main caregiver. On a more personal note, Dr. Doyley's hobbies were track and field, volleyball, and his favorite, baseball. He was a huge Sammy Sosa fan. Sammy Sosa is a baseball player from the Dominican Republic. While Dr. Doyley was at the university, he was on the baseball team as a team catcher. Where his children were concerned, he used to do track and field, especially with Yamilka and Elihu. Now, I won't bother to tell you the joke about Yamilka and her dad running down the street, because I cannot best her. So I will leave that part. Just remember that it's in here, because it meant so much to her. And I can just imagine him lying in the street, laughing at himself. He used to play volleyball in the evenings at the Manning School. He taught Nailia how to spike and showed her the correct way to serve. Dr. Doyley had a passion for singing and dancing. In Cuba, he and his friends would go out clubbing at any chance they got and would dance the night away. He sang very well and knew how to alter his tone when they did duets and trios. He continued to socialize a lot after he came to Jamaica. You would often see him drinking a red striped beer with friends, young and old. Dr. Doyley was also good at imitating people. He would imitate their voices, their facial expressions, and the way they walked. And he would joke around a lot. He had some funny sayings too. One of them was, "Me manners was green and goat near it." Reading was another passion that Dr. Doyley had. He loved to read whether day or night, especially his medical books. Despite all the experience he had, Dr. Doyley recognized the greater force in his life and was awed by the presence of God, who loved him very much, who loved him so very much. He believed in God so much that he got baptized in the year 2016. Everywhere he went, he had a Bible with him or little notebooks with Bible stories or verses which he would sit and read from time to time. Dr. Doyley was hospitalized on Wednesday, 3rd June 2020, and transitioned on Friday, 5th June 2020. The world is a sadder place without Dr. Doyley in our lives, especially in the lives of his children. Nevertheless, Dr. Doyley touched every one of us and has left us with memories we will cherish forever. Life is but a stopping place, a pause in what to be, a resting place along the road to sweet eternity. We all have different journeys, different paths along the way. We were meant to learn some things, but never meant to stay. Our destination is a place far greater than we know. For some, the journey is quicker. For some, the journey is slow. And when the journey finally ends, we'll claim great reward and find an everlasting peace together with the Lord. Dr. Noel Lloyd Doyley, gone but not forgotten. May his soul rest in peace.
We thank Miss Foote for taking us down the path of Dr. Doyley. Now, as we are here to celebrate his life, I'm going to ask you all to stand as we sing this beautiful hymn, In Your Hands. Place all our future in your hands, in your hands. We bid you take over all our lives, Lord. Our dreams, aspirations, all our best, Jesus, Lord. Our hopes, our fears, in your hands.
your hands, Lord, we place today and tomorrow. We surrender all in his hands. And that is something that Dr. Doyley had done before he left this earth. He surrendered all to Jesus Christ. Now we are going to go into the lesson, and the first lesson will be read by Lowan Doyley. And the scripture will be taken from John 14, verses 1 to 21. Lowan?
Hi, good afternoon, everybody. I'm Luan. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I would go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. And where I am, there ye may be also. And whether I go, you know, and the way we know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whether thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto me, unto the Father, but by me. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also, and from henceforth ye know him, and have seen him. Philip saith unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us. Jesus said unto him, Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. And how sayest thou them? Show us the Father. Believest thou not that I am in, not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and that the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also, and the greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever ye ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. If ye love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, and that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for the dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more, but ye see me, because I live, ye shall live also. At the day ye shall know that I am my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he is it that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved by my Father, and will love him and manifest myself to him. Amen.
Our second lesson will be taken from Ecclesiastic 3, 1 to 4, and it will be read by Allison Gordon.
Good afternoon.
afternoon, everyone. The scripture reading is taken from Ecclesiastes 3, reading from verse 1 to 4. There is an appointed time for everything, a time for every activity under the heavens, a time for birth and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot what was planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build up. Fourth and last, a time to weep, time to laugh, a time to wail, and a time to dance. Here ended the reading of God's holy word.
Thanks be to God.
All right. Now it is time for the word. And I pray that all hearts may be receptive to hearing the word of God. Let us be attuned to what the word of God has to say. Each one of us, each and every one of us, will have something to take from his word. Whatever aspect, whatever situation, the word of God will be able to penetrate every soul and speak to something that we are going through today. Whether we are grieving, whether we are rejoicing, whether we are celebrating, whatever it is, the word of God will be able to speak to you. And with no further ado, I would like to introduce our pastor who will bring the word this evening, Pastor Glester Leslie.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters. I want to say it's good to be in the house of the Lord. And if you ask me, where is the cross at the front? Think about it. Wherever we come to worship God is holy ground, is consecrated ground. So we are in the house of the Lord. I want to just begin by extending condolences to the family members. I don't know if your mother is here as yet, but Sister Hopi, siblings, brothers in Cuba, children in Cuba, neighbors, friends, loved ones, and the lady who was companion and caregiver, not sure if she's here, but she also is mourning, want to extend heartfelt sympathy to all of you. I feel somehow close to Dr. Doyley, if only because we have heard so much and learned so much about Dr. Doyley in this time so far, but also because from the very early, I started my business in Sav-la-mar in the mid-70s, and I've known Dr. Doyley since that time. And to this day, I can remember that broad smile, that larger-than-life persona, that smile that always went ahead of him. I can remember him, but we're also connected in some other way to the family. His mother-in-law, Sister Maud Brissett of blessed memory, was my church sister from Sigrid Street, knew her very well, got to know Hopi through Sister Maud very well. And of course, Yamilka, you told me last night when we spoke that you and my children went to the same school. And so, in a way, you are also my daughter, so the connection is there. And so we thank God for a life well lived. Of course, at times like these, we struggle with worry and we struggle with fear. But it's useful to remember that as we mourn the passing of a loved one, if we continue to trust in God, we can discover a peace that passeth all understanding, even as we learn to turn to our only source of help, and that help is God. Our Heavenly Father never takes his eyes off his children. That's what the Word of God tells us. And we're all his children. Whether we are good children, bad children, we're still his children. I'm going to, in a way, date myself now because I'm going to tell you about a song that was popularized in the early 1960s. And I bet I can probably count on one hand those of you who were around in the 1960s. But it was sung by Mr. John Rowles. And it was entitled, If I Only Had Time. So much to do, if I only had time. If I only had time, dreams to pursue. If I only had time, they'd be mine. Time like the wind goes a-hurrying by and the hours just fly. Where to begin? There are mountains that climb if I had time. And time is something that we take for granted. But we recognize that there comes a time when we recognize that time is never really to be taken for granted. The mother of a friend of mine died about 4 or 5 weeks ago. She lived to be 110. And the mother of another friend of mine died last week, Tuesday. She lived to be 102. Both would have been considered to be long livers, as we would call them in Jamaica. The lady who died at 110 years would have lived for over 3.5 billion seconds. I want to say this again. So those of you who are mathematicians can let it sink in and try to calculate it. The person who lives to 110 years would have lived for 3.5 billion seconds. No matter how many ways you cut it, no matter how many ways you count it or otherwise check it, the fact is, even if you live to 110, there is a limitation of our time on earth. Some people use an hourglass. Some people say there are so many moons. Some persons watch the movement of the sun each day. But whatever system of measurement you choose to use, the fact is, our time is very limited. You will now understand and appreciate why today I would like to spend a little time sharing with you and reflecting on a topic that we oftentimes take for granted, but have so little of. And so my theme for today is the simple four-letter word called time. And so I'm going to just use a text from Psalm 90 and verse 12, very popular text. And in it, Moses tells us, teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Let us pray. Mr. Father, you have given us all the time we need to accomplish what you have given us to do on this earth. May we use our time in ways that honor you, even as we pray in Jesus' name. So how do we use our time? There are 86,400 seconds in a day, and there are 31.5 million seconds in a year. We rush to go home daily before the curfew begins, and now, thank God, it is being extended further and further. You can now be on the street up to 11 o'clock. We get to work, or we get to church, or we get to school on time. We keep our business and personal appointments because we have to measure time. And we try to go to our meetings on time. We'll do all these things because we recognize that in spite of the over 3.5 billion seconds that we may have allocated in our lives on earth, time is still very limited. And there's a tendency when we're young, and I can speak for myself, when you're young, you're 10, 11, 12, 13, and the genes and the hormones start to pump in you. And you believe, say, you're a little boy, but if you say you're a man, and you're anxious to be a man at 25 and 30, so you can date the girls and go to dance and parties and so on. And up coming through that time, you figure, boy, I have time on my hands. Then people are old. To every child who is 5 or 6 and 7, anybody who is 10 years old, I look like an old person. I have a young sister-in-law when I was 25 and consider myself a young man, not even yet in my prime. And she said to somebody, she's talking to her friend, And say, so what old man like Uncle Glaister? I'm 25, you know. And she referring to me as an old man. And then 40 odd years later, and I still see, and my wife and I are talking, and we're talking about people we knew when we were young. And we're wondering, but how come such and such is still alive? Why? Because when we were age 20 and 21, those persons seem ancient. It turns out now that people might have been 30, 35. But somehow they always seem so much older. Time marches on. And then in the twinkle of an eye, time passes you by. And you're no longer on the upward climb, but you're now on the downward trajectory. So we generally say that we do not like to waste time. And that makes sense considering the limitations of our life here. But given the uncertainty of what lies ahead, we are well advised to consider what eternity may hold for us by referencing what lay behind us. So we can talk all we want about what we can do in this lifetime on earth. But the reality is, for those of us who know and believe in God, a time will come that is timeless. A time will come when we're no longer measuring in seconds or minutes or hours or days or years. A time will come when time will basically be no more. Scientists have told us that the earth is actually millions of years old, and that could well be so. And it doesn't really matter that it may seem to differ from the creation account. We tend to believe that based on where Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1 began, that the world is probably 5,000-6,000 years, based on the Genesis account and the Old Testament, and we know 2,000 years since Jesus came on earth. But I want to invite us all, if you want to say that there's a difference between what the scientists say and what the book of God says, I invite you to read again Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1. It says, in the beginning, God created the world. Full stop. And that pause could have been for 1 second, and that pause could have been for 1 billion years. We don't know. I wasn't there when the Bible was written, but I believe God. So we can choose to believe what we want. So by the same token, it may well be possible, if the world is indeed a couple of million years old, it may well be possible that in spite of the end time predictions that we continue to hear, we could possibly have another number of millions of years on Earth. It doesn't look that way, because every time a pandemic comes around, and history tells us that we have had a pandemic for every 100 years for the last 3 or so centuries. And every time a serious pandemic comes around, we start to say, boy, this is really the end. The end of the world is here. However, all of this is really wasted speculation, because the Bible tells us very clearly that, but as for that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father knows when the end will come. What we do know is that we all have an appointment that we must keep, no matter who you are. No matter where you go, whether you're pretty or ugly, whether you're old or young, whether you're black or white, whether you're rich or you're poor, we all have an appointment that we have to keep. The Bible reminds us in Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 27, and it is appointed for men to die once. But not just to die, because after we die, we have to face the judgment. And so, of course, some persons in the past have tried their utmost to avoid death. And we read constantly about persons who are very moneyed, who try all sorts of schemes to try to avoid death. But all of this is for naught, as we also know that there is a well-known proverb that reminds us that time waits for no man. And so one question that we all ponder and have thought about from time immemorial is, what really happens after death? And you're probably figuring that I'm about to let out the secret, but I don't know either. I've never been dead, not yet. But we can only go by what we believe and what we read in scriptures. I have found that different persons have varying beliefs, but personally, I believe what my Bible tells me in Revelations chapter 20 and verses 11 to 13. And I'm going to just share those few verses of scripture with you. Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God. And books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them, and they were judged each one according to their works. And for those of you who may want to just go home and read that passage of scripture again, it is Revelations 20 and verses 11 to 13. You see, I can stand up here and tell you all of what I want to tell you, but ultimately, it's all about what each of us want to believe in our hearts. Some of us believe, some of us choose not to believe. I do evangelistic work every Sunday in spite of the pandemic. What it has done is to create for us an opportunity in my church to create some Bible material that we take around to a chosen community. And so I now go and distribute about 300 pieces of Bible material to our community up at Smithfield, Hatfield, every Sunday. And in so doing, you find persons who receive the material with joy. But you also find the opposite. Two Sundays ago, I met a raving... Let me just put it politely. I said, the man was an atheist. And he starts to argue with me, oh, God, this and God, that. And I had to just walk him out because I really never had the time. We're still under curfew and promise him that one day we will talk again. Because you cannot just shy away and walk away from those who you consider to be not a child of God. Because we are all children of God. Okay? And the truth of the matter is, we are all sinners saved by grace. If I start to tell you my life story before I became a Christian, trust me, it's too colorful to talk about in church. Okay? So we are all sinners saved by grace. But the question is, who will judge us? And the Bible tells us further that it is not the Father, but rather it is the Son who will be the judge of all men. Now we can find that in the Gospel of John chapter 5 and verse 22. Mark 9 and verses 47 to 49 also reminds us that, and if your eye causes you to stumble, pluck it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into hell, where the worm never dies and the fire is never quenched, for everyone will be salted with fire. And some people like to dress up the Bible and pretty it up and don't speak the truth of the Bible. And so what you will find is that there are some Bibles that you won't find those two verses in, you know. Because it is too drastic. Okay? But that's the reality of the Bible. Some of us will go to a place where the worm never dies and the fire doesn't ever go out. We are adults. We can pick our choice whether we want to take that chance or not. I have made my choice. Question then is, what can we do or what shall we do? We now know that there's going to be a resurrection for all whenever that time comes. But we need not be afraid of the resurrection because the resurrection of Jesus over 2,000 years ago provides us with the promise that even though we will all have a grave, we will all have the assurance that death no longer holds any power over us. One day we will be resurrected to life anew. Every remnant of death, every remnant of war, of disease, of broken relationships, injustice, etc., will end and will disappear. So, Doc, it means I won't come to you to clean my teeth again, because my teeth will not be deteriorating, if I have any. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9 reminds us that the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand the slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. So now Moses' prayer in Psalm chapter 90 and verse 12 that I shared earlier comes into view. Teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. The Apostle Paul wrote, be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. So even as we mourn the loss of a loved one, we may encounter days when we feel lost and helpless. But we are well reminded that while we cannot prevent trials, heartaches, or loss, we can live with confident faith, relying on an ever-present helper and an ever-present protector who never takes his eyes off us, even as he watches over all our lives. I suspect that Paul and Moses would agree that our wise use of time is not just a matter of watching the clock. It is more a matter of using our time in the best or most productive way possible. We have just a brief moment of time to make a difference for Christ in the world. And that means that we have to make maximum use of that opportunity. Believe it or not, that may well mean ignoring our watches and clocks for a while and instead patiently show love to those persons whom God brings into our lives. Put another way, we might say that good time management is not about clock watching, but rather it is about making the most of the time that we have. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Ghost. Amen. And if we believed the word of God that we just heard, I invite us then to stand and to reaffirm the Apostles' Creed, which is printed on your programs. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. We'll have a minor alteration to the program as printed, and so at this time I'm going to invite Miss Elise Campbell to come and say the prayer for the family.
Good afternoon, everybody. Can we stand to send home Dr. Dalley? Oh, glory to God. Not in mourning. The Bible, Paul says, he have fought a good fight. He have run a race. He was a father indeed. before prayer, I just want to say this. I remember when he said, when he called me, Yamilka, he said, Sister Elise, Yamilka called me and said, Happy Mother's Day. He blowed my mind. He was so happy. Glory to God. I'm calling the family to stand. We should love each other. When God bind a family together, oh Jesus. In the congregation, just stretch your hands with me and agree with me. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I cover your children right now under the blood of Jesus. Father God, we bind principalities and powers. Father, in the name of Jesus, blanket them today. Oh God, let when they walk high with the blood of Jesus. Father God, once it's a Dalling in here today, we cover you under the blood of Jesus. Father God, in the name of Jesus, every family member today, oh God, we cover you right now. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, have your way in their lives. We pray going out and coming in. Father, Lord, have your way with them, God. Father, no matter what happen, Father, God Almighty, hold them in your hands. Father, Lord, God Almighty, we are nothing but dust. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, Eshaya, Mando Shekorobo Saya. Father, God Almighty, ah, God Almighty, one more time. I just want to give you glory. I just want these tears to be joyful. Oh, God, because he has fought a good fight. He has been a father, not only to you, but to many. But today, in the name of Jesus, oh, glory to God, we leave him in your hands. And so, in the name of Jesus Christ, everyone standing in the family, if you're sick today, we command you to be healed. Ah, God Almighty, in the name of Jesus, healing is your portion today. Ah, God Almighty, Father God, no COVID-19 shall come near your dwelling. In the name of Jesus, I speak over your life. I cover you in the name of Jesus. Oh, glory to God. You shall go in good health. You shall go in happy. You shall prosper. In the name of Jesus, that's the prayer that God wants for you today. You shall prosper in good health. You shall serve so high. Ah, God, today when I leave this podium, let your Father that is, I know, glory to God, that Hashikoro Messiah. There's a God in heaven that is watching over you. He is gone, but search in your heart. He's always here. Ah, God, and today I pray in the name of Jesus to comfort. I pray when you see the tears that you will remember him when he's laughing. You will not remember the pain of the past. My God, but today, God, I leave them in your hands. I cover them under the blood of Jesus. We give you thanks in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Sister Elise. It's a very powerful, powerful, powerful prayer. Let us continue and it's good. It's good to let the tears flow. It's part of the cleansing process. But just remember that the God of Jacob continues to be with you and he will bring you comfort. I pray that in the days to come that we will all include the family members in our prayers. Death is not an easy thing to cope with. Persons respond to death in different ways. But we need to lift them up and keep them in our prayers. So we continue in an attitude of prayer. Praise be to you, O God, our Father, who created us in your own image for eternal fellowship with you. Praise and thanksgiving to you, O Christ, our Lord and our God, who have overcome the sharpness of death and opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers and are now seated at the right hand of God in the glory of the Father. Praise and blessing be to you, O Holy Spirit, God, our Comforter, who bear witness within us of our acceptance with the Father and have become the pledge of our eternal inheritance. All praise and glory, blessing and honor, thanksgiving and worship be to you, O Blessed Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God forever and forever. Amen. We bless your name, Lord, for the life of him who we today lay to rest. We give you thanks for the joy and blessing his life has brought to others, for his service to his generation according to your will, and for every happy remembrance of his life. We bless you for your mercy and goodness, which have followed him all the days of his life, and that now the trials of this world are over and death itself is past. Receive him into your perfect kingdom, and bring us with all who have lived and served you faithfully to the fullness of your eternal joy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. At this point, I'm going to invite us to stand for the offertory hymn. And it's printed, "Mine Eyes Have Seen the Glory." And just a reminder that in the spirit of generosity that Dr. Doyley had, we ask that you be generous, as the family has asked, that the offertory be given to the Sav-la-mar Infirmary. So we ask that you be generous in giving your offering.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
blessing of the offering, please. Father in heaven, we give you thanks, Lord Jesus, for this offering. We ask your blessing, God, for those who had to give and those who had not to give. Father God, we pray that this offering may be used to the extension of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Before continuing, I just want to use this opportunity to say a very big thank you to Sister Dion for so ably leading the service in this fashion today. Can't say this morning again, it's now afternoon. But I met Dion for the first time in the office when I came today, and we introduced ourselves to each other. And of course, I didn't know what to expect, but I'm here to tell you publicly, you've done very well. I'm proud of you. And I would share a pulpit with you anytime. So I now ask that you stand as we do the commendation for our departed brother. Those who are able. Eternal God, who have made us all and hate nothing that you have made, and have given your Son for our redemption, we commend our brother Noel to your perfect mercy and wisdom. Eternal rest grant unto him. Amen. And let perpetual light shine upon him. And we say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and forevermore. Amen. Please be seated. Just before the benediction and the recessional hymn, I'd just like to remind us of the order in which we will recess. The platform party will lead, followed by the person, I hope we can find the family members to come back for the urn. So the person bearing the urn will come behind the platform party, along with family members, and then the rest of the worshipers will follow. So the platform party, followed by the urn and family members, and then followed by the worshipers in an orderly manner. May I invite us now to stand for the benediction. Now the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good thing to do his will, working in you that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and forever and forevermore. Amen. Amen. We now sing the hymn as we recess. When I've gone the last mile.
If I walk in the pathway of duty, if I work till the close of the day, I shall see the great King.